This time, we shall have a look at some basic approaches in reliability testing, specifically at estimating the sample sizes and testing times that are needed to achieve the desired confidence of the test results. Let's start with a simple one. In automatic transmissions, the parking position engages a locking system consisting of a park gear on the output shaft and a park pole with an actuation mechanism. The parking position should not be engaged when the car is still moving, as it puts very high loads to all connected components and may result in a fatal damage to the parking mechanism. But since it is still possible to engage parking mode at low speeds, the components should demonstrate some resistance to these not very frequent cases. This is manifested in an engagement speed test, representing a set of events. The mechanism is due to withstand in a lifetime. Let's say the required reliability is 90% with a 95% confidence. This means that we shall be 95% confident that at least 90% of all transmissions are capable of surviving the test. The transmissions are, of course, designed in a way that it is quite unlikely to see them fail in a test. So, how many parts do we need to test when none demonstrates a failure to prove meeting the criteria? This is a zero failure test whose results follow a binomial distribution. The binomiality is represented by either OK or not OK test result. Let's imagine the marginal case when there really is 90% of OK parts and 10% of the not OK parts in the whole infinite population of transmissions. The binomial distribution will tell how likely we will see zero failed if we randomly choose 10 parts or 15 or any other number. The number we need is when the likelihood of having zero failed parts drops below 5% and thus leaving 95% confidence that we would see at least one failure if the reliability is less than 90%. In our case, it is 29 transmissions. But what if we actually see one failed transmission in a test? How many more do we need to add to demonstrate the reliability now? We need to keep adding the parts in until there is less than 5% combined probability that either zero or one failure occurs. This is easier to see in a cumulative graph where the probabilities are already stacked. Here we need to raise the number of the tested parts to 46, quite higher than when there is no failure. Only with a number this high, we can be 95% confident that the whole population has no less than 90% of reliable parts when one failure occurs in the test. Such a high number of parts subjected to tests naturally raises concerns about the test costs, and many people consider running the test again on the already tested parts. Can we gain the same confidence with a lower sample size if we test each part, let's say, twice? Yes, this is possible, but we need to add one more information to the calculation. The needed information is an assumption about the shape of the distribution of the time to failure. The shape of the distribution will tell how the portion of the failed parts increases with an increased service time. Let's assume a constant failure rate, a special case corresponding to the Rayleigh distribution. With a constant failure rate, the reliability drops by 10% for every multiple of the life at 90%. This is an 81% reliability and 19% failure at twice the lifetime. Now we can calculate the needed sample size at 81% reliability instead of 90, which yields 15 parts for the 95% confidence and 0 failure. So, if we double the test for a component with a constant failure rate, we need to test 15 parts with 0 failed, 24 parts with 1 failed, 31 parts with 2 failed, and so on. In this way, we can change the test time to any portion or multiple of the targeted lifetime and calculate the needed sample size accordingly. Just be careful about extending or reducing the test time too much, because the more away we are from the targeted life, the more influential is the assumption about the constant failure rate. Of course, the constant failure rate is a very theoretical concept that can seldom be found in most practical applications. With the time to failure, we need to deal with diverse distribution shapes. This is often done by assuming a viable distribution that changes its shape to various forms according to just one shape parameter. The viable distribution models the constant failure rate when the shape equals 1. When the shape is less than 1, the failure rate decreases, and when the shape is more than 1, the failure rate increases. The higher is the shape, the more compressed is the time span in which most components fail, which is mostly beneficial. Determining the viable shape is a very wise way of influencing the statistical calculations by using a technical competency, a concept known as Bayesian inference. A specific technical knowledge about the nature of the anticipated failures is priceless in most reliability calculations. If we have, for example, good reasons to believe that the components will mostly suffer from early failures, the viable shape will be low, at most 1. On the other hand, if we know that the failures will likely occur due to material fatigue, the shape will mostly be more than 2, as there is some service time needed before the failures can actually demonstrate themselves. The lower we set the viable shape, the more conservative will be the calculation, so we really only need to set its lower bound. And one more note. As we need to target a relatively high reliability at a controlled time from the start of operation, we should not be surprised that the typical life of the components will actually be much higher in most applications. This may seem unnecessary and may be wasteful, but it is the only way of controlling low failure rate at the important time. And likewise, the test time shall generally be in the typical life region rather than around the target life. Let's see an example now for a manual transmission. A clutch plate with frictional segments shall be designed to 95% reliability at 150,000 kilometers of a typical customer usage. We need to decide how long to test if we have 10 parts available and we want to be 95% confident about a positive test result. Based on an expectation of a bare failure, we estimate the viable shape to be 1.4. As we are looking for the time, rather than for the sample size, we need to proceed backwards. First, let's see which failure rate corresponds to a 5% risk, which is a 95% confidence in the binomial distribution, for a sample size of 10. The failure rate is 26% for 0 failed, 40% for 1 failed, and so on. Let's work with the 26% failure rate that corresponds to 74% reliability at that time. This animation shows the reliability function with the criteria of 95% reliability at 150,000 km. The testing time for 10 parts with zero failures is the time at 74% reliability. If we start with a constant failure rate, the testing time would be almost 900,000 km for each of the 10 parts and would increase with the decreasing viable shape. If we increase the viable shape to the estimated 1.4, the testing time is approximately 530,000 km, which is the answer we are looking for. If we had an additional technical knowledge that would justify a more compact time span of failures, we could be able to further increase the viable shape and lower the testing time even more. Please remember that the needed confidence in reliability testing is an outcome of binomial distribution, which controls the likelihood that a potentially positive test result is not obtained only due to lucky circumstances. If we want to test the specimens for a period of working duty that is different from the target life, we need to make competent assumptions about the properties of the time-to-failure distribution. In the daily life, all presented calculations are much better to be done by using a proper piece of software rather than manually or by making fancy animations. But remember, the software is only as good as is the competency of its user.